Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the session, Qualified Equality, Minorities in the Constitution of Pakistan. Our panelists for this session are Shaqaib, Lilla, Zain, Mansoor, Babar, Sattar. Our moderator for this session is Irfan, Mufti. I will take this opportunity to introduce the moderator for this session. He's a Lahore-based civil activist who holds a master's degree in social and cultural anthropology and MPhil in American history. He has been an active participant in social movements, human rights bodies, and peace coalitions in South Asia for more than two decades. He is founding member of the Six Country Development and Advocacy Consortium, South Asia Partnership. He's currently serving as its director of programs. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning to everybody. And that's just a change in the panel. We are unfortunate that Ms. Romana Bashir, she couldn't join us for this session today. But she is replaced by Safiya Aftab, who is another very leading development worker. Just to start, this session will focus primarily on the angle of Constitution of Pakistan. We would like to explore in detail that how Constitution of Pakistan cover the status of minorities, and when we say minorities, in this case, religious minorities, and what are the areas which are important in terms of their equal status or otherwise, if there are any discriminatory clauses or article we would like to emphasize on it. As we said earlier, this is also covered in a research study, which I'm sure most of you must have a copy of it now. We will also give a summary of our findings in this document. I would like to first introduce my panelists. We are very lucky to have a very strong panel for this session. On my right side, Mr. Shaqaib Aslam Lilla. He's a practicing lawyer, especially focusing on constitutional law, and he conducts research on constitution primarily from the focus of fundamental rights. He also teaches at different law colleges in Rawalpindi and Islamabad, and he teaches constitutional law and human rights. On the further right, Mr. Zain Mansoor, he's also a practicing lawyer, and he also does litigation cases and also focusing on rights and particularly from the angle of constitution. On my left, Safiya Aftab, she is a researcher and also she works in a development sector, and she covers a fairly broad range of issues including human rights and minority rights. And then on my further left is Mr. Babar Sattar, very well known journalist and lawyer, constitutional lawyer. He is also a political commentator on such issues. So we are lucky to have him in the panel today. Thank you very much, everybody, to join us. Just to give a quick prologue about the issue. If you look at the fundamental reasons of why Muslims of India created a separate homeland for themselves was also the fear of majority. They were having a fear that if in a united India they might be in the minority under a dominant Hindu majority. So that probably was became a reason for them to struggle for a separate homeland. But what happened in last 70 years? But we see that being a majority, the minorities in their country face and felt the same kind of persecution and insecurity. So that negates the whole, the basis and the reason of creating this country. On the other side, if you look at our laws and constitution, we find that although there are some chapters or articles of fundamental rights which provide equal status to all citizens, but in the same constitution we find certain areas which are very discriminatory nature. But if you look at the laws, you find serious issues of discrimination in our various laws. So that makes the situation very complicated. But what we see in last 70 years, that gradually we see a very downward trend where the minorities are persecuted, not only under the law or under different other policies, but gradually also targeted and persecuted through social and political means. And in last at least 1.5 decades or 2 decades, we see very strange kind of a situation where the mob violence is also is targeting minorities under different pretexts, either blasphemy cases or otherwise. So this is a situation where we see that the minorities in Pakistan are living. And that makes this issue extremely important for us to examine from the angle of law and constitution, that what are the reasons that eventually result into social and political chaos. Therefore, I would like to now request Mr. Shaqaib Aslan, Zain Mansoor Saab, to give us an overview and a summary of his finding of the research, which is titled as Qualified Equality, Minorities in the Constitution of Pakistan. So he will give us a quick summary about his findings. Over to you, Zain Saab.
Right. The thing is, when we started this research, and what we wanted to do with the research was that with regards to minorities, what our constitution has done and what has our constitution, because we in our 70-year history, nearly 70 years of history, we've had 3 constitutions, and those 3 constitutions, the last of which was one of the, we celebrate that constitution as being a unanimous constitution where everybody was joined in and agreed upon it. Since the constitution was introduced or was abrogated in 1973, there have been 21 amendments to that particular constitution. Now, if you look at the constitution, we'll have to see what kind of rights this constitution has given our citizens, and what kind of rights this constitution is giving these particular minorities. Because if you look at we looked at how the population of Pakistan changed from being nearly 20% of comprising of 20% of minorities in 1947 to just over 3% minority people in Pakistan right now. So we just wanted to look at how the constitution has changed and how has been changed and how the constitution is dealing with these things. If you look at the constitution, it is basically all modern constitutions, and particularly in Pakistan also, it gives you two particular rights. One are the negative rights and one are the positive rights. Positive rights being the one in which the government has nothing to do, the government has to do and provide some particular rights to the population, just like example being the ones like education and health and protection of property and stuff. And negative rights being where the government doesn't have to do a lot of things, it just has to not interfere in their right, just like the right of property, the right of life, and the right to have the freedom to have a religion and to profess it and to propagate it and stuff like that. We as a nation take Qaid-e Azam's word, and because he is the founder of this country, we take his words very seriously. We academics do, but whatever happens in the society, that's something else that we're going to discuss. But as he has been the guiding he has been the guiding person, and his words have been the guiding principles, we've always said that he has always advocated that everybody in this country was free to do anything that they wanted, remaining within the ambits of the law and remaining within being equal citizens of the state. But what we have seen in this society and in this constitution is that the constitution does provide a lot of rights in the first chapter, being I'll give you a brief outlook of, but anyways, it open. The constitution provides a lot of rights. It under Article 25 of the constitution, it provides. Yep. Article 8, it provides that any law or any custom of usage having the force of law in so far as it is consistent with the rights conferred by this chapter shall to the extent of such consistency be void. Now this chapter, which involves all these rights, the freedom to profess religion, the freedom to the safeguard against taxation for the purpose of any particular religion, equality of citizens, safeguard to the educational institutions in respect of religion, non-discrimination in respect of access, all these rights are provided by the Constitution. But what has happened is that the Constitution, apart from these rights, also is guided by the principle of policy that the government has put in this Constitution, which is that it is going to propagate the Islamic way of life, Article 31, and most importantly, Article 36, that the protection of minorities is paramount for the government. Now, what has happened is that Islamic provisions have been added into this constitution, making this constitution, a color of Islam or an Islamic document, whatever you want to say it. But what has happened is that the history has started from the objective resolution that was adopted in 1949 by the Constitutional Assembly. One thing that you note in this objective resolution was that no minority member ever voted for this objective resolution, and it was not originally part of the 1973 constitution. It was added by General Ziaul Haq in 1985. Now it's been part of the. Now, what we have looked is looking at all those fundamental rights that have been provided by the Constitution, like I said, now we have to look at the Islamic provisions that have been provided by the Constitution. And if you look at the Islamic provisions, there are quite a few which says that Islam is going to be the religion of the state, that it's going to be Islamic way of. The Article 41 provides that no non-Muslim is going to be the president of the Republic of Pakistan. Then there is the Federal Sharia Code, and then there is the Islamic Council, and then there is the functions of the Islamic Council. All this, we had to examine what has been happening with the Constitution and how this has affected the ordinary lives of the people of Pakistan. Now, one of the most important ways of judging how this whole thing has happened and how this has been affecting the lives of the people is how these articles and how these laws are being interpreted by the judiciary of Pakistan. We were surprised, to be very honest, coming from how we saw it in the society, that the judiciary has been quite liberal and quite staunch in its support for the minorities. The judiciary, believe it or not, all these, whether it's been the issue of verification of pleadings that any person, regardless of his faith, can actually go and verify any pleadings or be a reliable witness or be getting their identification or protecting their properties or with regards to promotion, believe it or not, all this has been issues that have been pleaded and have been carried have been brought before these courts to decide whether a non-Muslim can actually be promoted in government services or not. So the judiciary has been quite liberal in promoting the issues, the rights of the minorities. What we have discovered is that although they have been promoting the rights of the minorities, but there is one particular minority which has not been protected either by the constitution or has been singled out by the constitution and has also not been given any kind of protection by the judiciary, and that is the Ahmadis. Now the Ahmadis have been declared as non-Muslims by an amendment of the constitution that was first introduced in 1974 under the second amendment, and that was with the particular definition of Muslims and non-Muslims. That was a far open-ended definition of a Muslim, but which was changed in 1985, which by an amendment, and that's in the report, and the wording of the amendment is which provides for particular communities or particular people who are not Muslims. So in that particular amendment, Qaidianis or Ahmadis, whatever you want to say, have been declared as non-Muslims. Furthermore, different statutes for different laws have been introduced to scrutinize these Ahmadis and give some or provide some limits as to how they can profess or propagate or how they can express their religion in a particular manner in the state of Pakistan. So all these, this anti-Islamic activity of the Qaidiani group, Lahori group, and Ahmadi's Prohibition and Punishment Ordinance 1985, it made a criminal offense for Ahmadis to do any of the following: to call or pose themselves directly or indirectly as Muslims or refer to them, and to preach or propagate posing as a Muslim, or to call people to prayer by reciting Azan, or to refer their place of worship as Masjid, or to refer any person as Amirul Mu'mineen, and all this. And it particularly gave a punishment of 3 years, imprisonment of 3 years, and fine also for anybody who was caught doing so. So what we have, this was our particular study. Pakistan has also a lot of responsibilities under international law also. So we had to look into that also. But what has been happening here is that all this has been going on under the guise or under the umbrella of the constitution. And so what our findings was, that's what...
Thank you, Zain. A very good overview. And thank you for enlightening us about how the constitution treat different citizens differently. I come to Shaqaib now. You see, constitution is also a social contract between state and citizen, and it provides legitimacy to state over individuals. How do you analyze this whole constitution, especially what Zain was mentioning about different discriminatory and competing clauses within constitution? So how would you analyze this whole constitution from the angle of social contract and even constitutionalism, the practices of constitutionalism in other part of the world? Yes, over to you.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for being here. I would appreciate AAWAZ's efforts at the onset, actually, for providing us with this opportunity to write this paper. Thank you so much again for being here. The objective actually of the study is mentioned on page 2 in the first paragraph, line 4, if you guys can kindly see in the booklet provided to you. It actually manifests our ideal and the study conducted. Regarding constitutionalism, I would advocate this idea that there is this concept of limited government, which unfortunately we don't observe in our state. The basic ideal is that there is a relationship between the state and the individual. There is this boundary which the state cannot cross, and there are laws which the citizen has to abide. it is our rights which we have given to the state. It is not the state which has given us these rights, actually. I have been hearing this since my childhood, that everybody is equal. Har insaan barabar hai. Unfortunately, I haven't seen the practical manifestation of this. I've been hearing koi gora hai, koi kala hai, koi gareeb hai, koi ameer hai. It is the state that has to ensure, and it is the state that has to look at it from that lens, that each and every individual of the state is equal. Alright, so regarding the fundamental rights, our concept is of the Constitution of Pakistan, the rights are enshrined in the chapter of fundamental rights. Regarding equality, it is mentioned in Article 25 that everybody is equal before the law. Now, it does not state that if an individual is poor, he would not be treated equally, or if an individual actually is a non-Muslim, he would not be treated equally. Fortunately, there are many provisions in the Constitution of Pakistan which actually guarantee the rights of each and every citizen of Pakistan. The unfortunate thing is that there are certain provisions in the Constitution of Pakistan which make it difficult for the implementation of the ideals present in the chapter on human rights in our Constitution. There are issues, unfortunately. My conclusion actually would be, and I would say it in the words of Ghalib actually. Ghalib says, ke, I forgot his share actually, unfortunately. Raat din gardish mein hai saat aasma. Raat din gardish mein hai saat aasma. Ho rahega kuch na kuch ghabraye kya. So that's the unfortunate story of our three organs of the state. Everybody has been sleeping. Fortunately, at certain occasions, the judiciary has played a proactive role, but it is not enough. That's my conclusion. Thank you.
I come to you, Babar Sahab. This is extremely important issue. What we have heard from Zain and Shaqaib now is that the Constitution, of course, has certain discriminatory characters and elements in it. But what Zain also mentioned, that the judiciary has been slightly progressive and liberal in terms of dealing with such cases. So but we see that the Constitution might be slightly or more discriminatory, but the judiciary has been more sympathetic to such cases. Do you agree to that? Or if you think that that is not the case, how you see the Constitution actually provides the ground for hate that we see in the society at the moment? So over to you, Babar Sahab.
Thank you, Irfan Sahab. I think it's in my personal interest to say that the judiciary is really good, because I appear before them on an everyday basis. Unfortunately, I see no difference really between the judiciary and the other organs of the state. I think the authors have been nice to our constitution and the judiciary. See, there are inherent limitations in what the judges can do, just in terms of the role, because there is a text that they're interpreting, and there is only so much that you can do with the text. When it's, if there's a bad text, what is it that you can do while interpreting it? There's only X you can do. So that is one. But if we actually look at what the judiciary has done, it's always sided with power. That's the unfortunate reality. One of the things that the authors in this report, they quote a minority judgment of Shafi Rahman Saab in the Ahmadi case. Now, that's a very interesting case. We talk about Article 20 of the Constitution, which says that you can actually propagate your religion. And then we have Section 298C, which was introduced by Zia-ul Haq, which says that Ahmadis cannot propagate their religion. And what we understand very clearly from our constitution is that constitution is a higher principle, and every other law has to then abide by the constitution. So the matter goes to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, through a majority of 4-1, decides that this law is fine, it's constitutional, to prohibit Ahmadis from propagating their religion. So that was the Zahir judgment. Then we've seen other judgments similarly. There was a case which went to the Federal Shariat Court when Zia-ul Haq brought in the Hudood Ordinance, and the Rajam, the punishment of Rajam, which is not really implemented, stoning we don't see it get implemented because the society would be outraged, irrespective of what you decide as a matter of law, but we don't see anybody stoned to death in the society. But the matter went to the Federal Sharia Court, and the judges decided that it was repugnant to Islam. 45 ulamas go and meet the general. The general changes the constitution of the Federal Sharia Court overnight, and a new bench of the Federal Sharia Court then declares that Rajam is constitutional. And so we've had Rajam ever since. When we go into courts, we see judges wear their belief system on their sleeves every single day. They're moralizing. You enter into a court, it starts with the recitation of the Holy Quran. Now that's fine. As a Muslim, you know, it's revered, the Quran, and it's fine to start your day. But in a court of law where there can be non-Muslims, so if there is a Hindu or a Christian or a minority person sitting there in that court, you start the day with the recitation of the Quran, that doesn't really send the message that this is a court where everyone before this court is equal. And this didn't happen 15 years back. Courts did not start like this. But it's changed. Justice Tasadduq Jilani, in the report, they mention a progressive judgment given by the Supreme Court in a suo moto case a couple of years back. That was, it's great, but it was almost an apology to the minorities. Because, A, there are limitations of the law. Legal equality will not always translate into social equality or political equality or economic equality anywhere in the world. But then our constitution is inherently an unequal document. Like, there is no way to dance around this basic issue. In terms of religious rights, there are individual rights. I believe what I believe as a matter of my faith. The constitution does guarantee that. But then there are communal rights. As a community, you organize yourself in a certain way. Now, the provisions that have just been pointed out, forget the fundamental rights for a minute. The principles of policy say you will encourage the Islamic way of life. You will not encourage people to live in accordance with their belief system. It doesn't say that. It says the state will encourage an Islamic way of life. Then you've created a Federal Sharia Court. You've created a Council of Islamic Ideology that will advise the parliament to conform all laws to Islam. Now, it doesn't say that there's going to be a Council of Islamic Ideology advising the parliament, and then there's also going to be a Council of Minorities advising the parliament as to how parliament should formulate laws and encourage and enable the minorities to live in accordance with their belief system. So I think what we have is a chance system. We've come down to a point where what a court will decide essentially comes down to who is sitting on the bench. And so rights are contingent. If it wasn't Justice Tasadduq Jilani sitting on the bench or being the Chief Justice at the time that there was a blast in a church, we wouldn't have seen the suo moto judgment that's come out. It's a progressive judgment, but at other times we've seen conservative judges give out judgments which totally desecrate the rights of minorities. So that's where we are. And I think the fundamental problem really is that we just going around in circles, not trying to debate the fundamental problem or the underlying the constitution, which is, are we an Islamic state or are we a Muslim majority country? If we are an Islamic state, then it has a very different character, which is reflected in the constitution. If you are a Muslim majority country, then we are 95% Muslim, and consequently, everyone who's in the parliament will bring their moral thinking to laws, and so laws will be predominantly Muslim. And just like the United States is a predominantly Christian country, or India is a predominantly Hindu country, But that's not the nature of the state. What is the purpose of the state? Is the state there to enforce religion, or is the state there to encourage or facilitate people to live in accordance with their beliefs? And we're not having that debate in this country. And I think there is a big myth, which is that the Constitution is a consensual document, and if we fidget with it at this stage, heavens are going to fall. But we've seen the 21st Amendment, where for the first time the Supreme Court has said that military courts are fine, for example. And they've said, we've got the right to strike down constitutional amendments. They'd not said that since the 1973 Constitution, even though they were encouraged to say it multiple times. But we will always somehow stop short of bringing this debate alive as to what is the purpose of this state, and are people really equal here? If you look at the Human Rights Report this time, there, it cites a very interesting case where there's a Hindu temple being reconstructed in Peshawar, and part of the agreement that was produced before the Supreme Court was that the temple will be reconstructed, but they're not going to propagate their faith there. They're not going to have big religious functions there. So that's the kind of rights that we're affording to minorities. Ahmadis are still on a separate electoral list. If nothing else, that's like a killing machine. And so that's where we are right now, without actually getting into this debate and calling ourselves and our justice system and our constitution hypocritical. I don't think we're going to make progress. So we just have to acknowledge that.
Thank you very much, Babar Sahib. I think you have given a very good interpretation how this whole thing has been manifested as an ideological state. And as an ideological Islamic state, how it has manifested itself into different political and social spheres. Coming to you, Safiyaji, you see, as far as what we have heard from these technical experts or constitutional experts is that there are some bases of this contradiction within our constitution and laws. But we see that this whole ideology was actually making part of our curriculum, the hate speeches were promoted against minorities through different ways. Mosques were doing it. Even public forums were doing it. So what we see in last at least 30 years that the minorities have been subject to different kind of hate and violence. And that is very worrisome, that it is not just the state which is ultimately is protecting their ideology, but it's also society who's adopting it as its ideological base. So how do you see as a social activist that this whole thing is actually taking us, and where is the chaos coming, and how can we address it?
Basically legislation sets a standard for society. Human beings or human nature has a tendency to be wary of the other. And human beings have a tendency to organize themselves into groups, like-minded groups, and to view anything different with suspicion. But the state is supposed to protect against those sort of tendencies. The state has to make sure that all its citizens are treated equally and that the same rights are given to all. The state has to set different standards compared to the standards that human beings set for themselves. And unfortunately, we are seeing a situation here where there is legislation on the books which opens up a window of opportunity for the, let me say, the base aspects of human nature to manifest themselves. So, for instance, when you declare a certain sect non-Muslim, that was difficult enough, but then on top of that, you put in legislation which actively stops them from practicing their religion or promotes the view of this sect as a subversive sect in society, then you create an opening for certain elements in society to go beyond the discrimination that is already in the law and to actually, carry out. There have been murders, there have been cases of students being asked to leave colleges, there have been any number of examples that we've seen in the last 20 years or so against one sect. And this can actually happen with anybody. It does not stop at one particular group. Once legislation is created which gives society a window of opportunity to discriminate, that it's going to be a very, very evolved society which will not pick up that opportunity. And unfortunately, we are not that evolved. Pakistan's not the only country where this has happened. So we cannot beat ourselves up, too much. This is not the only country where this has happened. There have been, in human history, unfortunately, many, many examples of sustained systematic discrimination against minorities, but this is no excuse. We need to learn from those sort of situations and from that history and to prevent that happening in this society. And it is important that the state steps up to prevent that. It's not up to citizens so much as it is up to the state to enforce an equal law for all and to take action where there are transgressions.
Thank you very much. Coming back to you, Zain, you covered, you see, there are Islamic provision within the constitution which were added at different stages. But Pakistan is also a signatory of Universal Declaration of Human Rights and several other international conventions and treaties which somehow put a binding on state of Pakistan to comply with those human fundamental rights and those treaties. How do you think that Pakistan constitution can justify itself while we as a state are also signatory to those fundamental freedoms and others? So where do you see the contradiction, and if there are contradictions, how to address those?
Sattar Saab and Safiya Bibi and everybody has said that, what has happened here is that the state has been an active participant in particularly discriminating against these minorities. Now, I would be bold enough to say this, but we have to recognize this also in all sectors of our governments or all sectors of the society, especially when the executive and the parliament itself, like Sattar Saab has said, that the manifestation of a particular one, particularly one religion in all sectors or particularly in the judiciary, it's not going to encourage any minority to come up and say these things, right? So one has to acknowledge that first, acknowledge that there is discrimination in this constitution, there is an inherent power which inherent discriminatory attitude towards minorities, and then we'll have to first the government, the executive and the judiciary and the parliament, they'll have to change these laws to be able to give a fair country for everybody to practice their own religion and to live their own lives. Unless and until we do that, it's not going to happen, and there won't be any change, and we can see as to what has been happening in this country for the last 25 years or 30 years, and it'll continue happening. And like Safiya said, it's not going to stop here, because you can see that Islam itself has a lot of different sects. So who can say that one day another sect is going to come into power and say, right, so this particular form of Islam is right, and the other other sects of Islam are not right. So we are going to make that also illegal for everybody else to propagate that or profess that particular kind of Islam. So you just have to stop somewhere and then decide as to what you have to do.
Okay.
Shaqaib, add to that.
I would like to comment on the international law bit. Unfortunately, UDHR is just a declaration. There are no implementation mechanisms in it. As regarding ICCPR, it is an international instrument which has implementation mechanism, but unfortunately, they are very, very weak. And the state of Pakistan has ratified ICCPR, which is the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. But unfortunately, then again, one, the implementation mechanisms are very, very weak. Secondly, we have signed certain reservations because of which it is impossible to implement those ideals which are enshrined in the ICCPR.
Babar Sahib, if I come back to you now, you see, this is a serious issue now, and it is not only just affecting the society but also the politics of the country, and what we see is that minorities are really pushed to the wall. How do you see that this issue can be resolved, can be addressed? Shall we start from the constitution first, or shall we start from the social attitude first? Shall we start from from looking at the laws which then discriminate minorities, or shall we start with the curriculum or creating a more conducive political environment for minorities first? So where do you think that we should start first and we should take things forward?
Irfan Saab, that's always the chicken and egg. But I think it's the social consensus that then feeds into law. There's a time lag generally between a society evolving and then law responding to a social consensus. I think we've got to ask the questions. We're not even having that conversation right now. We have a strange constitution which says there's a lot of conversation on Article 2A, for example, that it introduces the ideology of Pakistan, etc., within the constitution and other provisions. There's very little debate about Article 2, which says that the state has a religion and the religion is Islam. Now, that to me has always sounded very strange. How can a state have religion? Religion is a belief system. How can a state have a belief system and it's an artificial creation? But once you put that in there, that the state is Islamic, that the state has a belief system, then in that state, minorities will always be second-grade citizens. They can never be equal citizens because there is, clearly the Constitution is saying, this is who I am and you are the other, and consequently what we have is that we have an attitude of protection. The report put up the language of principles of policy which says to protect minorities. Now, tolerating someone is one thing and having an equal right is another thing. We're not here having a conversation in this country where somebody can stand up and say, we are equal citizens as a matter of right, I can do X, Y, and Z. You don't have to tolerate me because this is my right. But our entire conversation around this issue is one of tolerance. We should be nice to the minorities because they're not equal. So I think we need to ask these questions and we should not worry. My only suggestion is we should not worry about opening this question once again because it's happening in the society. There is no harm opening and debating it publicly as to what the nature of state should be and what should be its relationship with religion.
Very much. I think you have raised a very fundamental point here that without changing the religious character and ideological character of the state, we cannot move forward. Sophia, I'm coming to you. We see social attitude, very discriminatory, very hate-centered. How do you see we should start working on these social attitudes and change the social conditions for minorities? What should we do for this?
Well, frankly, there's a short-term, in my opinion, there's a short-term solution and there's a long-term solution. And the long-term solution is, of course, something that we all talk about, curriculum, teaching our young people and children about inclusion, etc. That's a long-term thing. But in the very short term, I would actually defer to the legal experts here. I think we need to see a situation where the law enforcement agencies, the government, and in the larger context, the state is actually cracking down on instances of illegal discrimination. So that you don't turn a blind eye, you don't look the other way when somebody's rights are being trampled. So actually go ahead and prosecute when Hindu temples are being burnt down or when Christians are being, dragged into brick, those kilns and sort of murdered, or when false blasphemy charges are being put and so on. Then the state has to actually step up and show that this is not acceptable and that, they have to, that nobody can take these initial steps against anybody. So I think in the short term, it is a case of the state establishing its writ, and the state has to be convinced that it has to establish its writ. In the longer term, of course, there are other things you need to do, but, that's a very long-term change.
Thank you.
Now I open the floor for questions, comments, and suggestions. Keep it brief. Keep it focused, and if you want to name anybody from the panel that you want to the question to be addressed. So I start from here, as you said. Just introduce yourself, and then I go back to these two friends here, and a friend over there. Yeah, just keep it brief. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. My name is Ishtiaq Ahmed, and I'm a veteran political scientist, and I was very much intrigued by what this gentleman and the lady said. I think the basic problem is that we have to distinguish between a constitution and constitutionalism to begin with. A constitution can have any sort of arbitrary laws. For example, the Nazis introduced race laws, and that became the basis of comprehensive discrimination against the Jews. South Africa had apartheid written into its constitution. And then you have Iran, which declares openly that it's a Shia Jafri state. Saudi Arabia doesn't have a constitution, but it's openly a Wahhabi state. So, constitution-wise, you can have all sorts of discriminations included. Constitutionalism is a process which started with the social contract theory, which assumes that the state is a limited entity created by the consent of the people. And in that sense, then begins a long-drawn process of the rights of individuals vis-a-vis the king and vis-a-vis other actors in society. One thing, and may I just refer to another issue which was raised, and that is the United Nations. You see, in the UN system, states are sovereign entities, and intervention is allowed only when we can prove that there is a threat to world peace or a genocide is underway. Short of that, so the states can get away with human rights violations because there is no will in the international system to intervene and rectify the system.
Shall I move? Yeah. Please help him. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm Sumant Batra. I'm a lawyer from India. So was very much interested in listening to this conversation. And I must say that I was quite impressed by the very progressive observations that were made by this panel. I just want to add one comment to the question that you asked. In fact, that was the last question, whether the change in the law should happen first or in the social mindset. In my opinion, it is important to have the change in the law first, and so as much to be able to create a contradiction between the law and the social practices, and then have an independent judiciary, which is therefore then able to enforce the law and make sure that the contradictions do not exist and they are inconsistent with the law. We have to recognize that even though the Constitution may provide a level playing field, the implementation is in the hands of the institutions which are headed by individuals which have their own belief, their own faith, and they would always make an effort to in some way or the other do things which they believe are correct. And therefore I think it is very important to have a very vibrant, independent judiciary which can step forward and make sure that as and when the law, the Constitution is violated, or any attempt is made to breach it, it should be corrected, and very firmly. And that is what how we have seen it in India as well, because you know that the India Constitution provides for a secular state, but yet we see discriminations happening every day, but the Supreme Court steps in, the courts step in, and it's taken 60 years, and it's an ongoing process. So you can't wait for one to happen.
Thank you.
For the other to happen.
I think you have made very, very important point.
Thank you.
Yeah, friend behind you, please.
Sorry.
No.
So can you pass?
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, the friend over there.
My name is Sheikh Danish Aftakhar. I am a qualified barrister at law. My question is to Mr. Babar Sattar Saab, that you said that there is a council of Islamic ideology but not a council of minorities which would advise the parliament. I would like to ask that in that case, do you think that Quran, or in for that matter Islam, does not have adequate protection for minorities, so it could advise the parliament as to the rights of minorities? Secondly, sir, I want to ask you that 82% of Pakistanis, they want Islamic system and strictly Islam, Quranic law as per the Sharia. That is not according to me, that is according to the Pew Research Center survey. So I want to ask you that whether that majority which is asking for the implementation of the Quranic law, whether that is, in your view, not a good sign for the coming times or Pakistan, for the contemporary society.
Thank you very much, Barrister Saab. Friend over there, yes.
जी, मेरा नाम कपिल देव है और मेरा ताल्लुक थरपारकर से है, एंड आई एम हिंदू, एंड आई स्वेयर बाय गॉड आई एम पाकिस्तानी हिंदू। तो मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि बाबर सत्तार साहब, आपने जो बात की है कि प्रोग्रेसिव लेजिस्लेशन हुई है, और जस्टिस तसद हुसैन जिलानी की जो 19 जून और 2014 की जो वर्डिक्ट आई थी, तो वो काफ़ी एक अच्छी प्रोग्रेसिव, पर बात यह कि जो निचली सतह पर हमारी जो कोर्ट्स है, ग्रास रूट लेवल पर जो कोर्ट्स है, लोअर कोर्ट्स, वहाँ पर कितना हमारा जो जस्टिस डिलीवर होता है, क्या फोर्स्ड कन्वर्जन के कितने केसेज हर माह हमारे यहाँ सिंध में रजिस्टर होते हैं, कितने केसेस में हमारे पास इंसाफ मुहैया होता है। दूसरी बात, आवाज़ के लिए थैंक यू, आपने अच्छा एक काम किया है, मगर इसका टाइटल मेरे ख्याल में क्वालिफाइड इनइक्वलिटी होना चाहिए था, या डिसक्वालिफाइड इक्वलिटी होनी चाहिए था।
थैंक यू,
ठीक है।
आई स्टार्ट विद, आई विल कम बैक टू अदर राउंड। आई स्टार्ट फ्रॉम बाबर साहब, आई थिंक इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन दैट फ्रेंड हैज रेज्ड। या
वेरी क्विकली, देयर आर, वी एज मुस्लिम्स कैन थिंक दैट इस्लाम इज अ सॉल्यूशन टू एवरीथिंग, एंड अदर्स who don't believe in Islam as their faith might not be convinced. So to say that Islam protects everyone else and they should be fine with it is a very internal way of looking at the other. And that's exactly our problem as a society, that we say we can protect you, as opposed to saying, okay, what is it that you're comfortable with? That's the first thing.
I think in a country that is overwhelmingly Muslim, anytime you'll do a survey that should we live our lives in accordance with Islam, the overwhelming majority will say yes. As a Muslim, nobody will ever turn back and say, I don't want to live in accordance with the injunctions of the Quran. Nobody, no Muslim or practicing Muslim will ever say that. But that's the challenge. The challenge of Islam is the challenge of interpretation. There are strict constructionists and there are liberal constructionists. And within the Islamic jurisprudence, that is the debate that's going on. Are you going to, who's going to interpret what the word of God means? Because God isn't here. You know, it's human beings that have been interpreting the word of God for 1400 years. And that's where the difference arises. That's where the different maslaks arise. And that's where interpretations come in. Strict constructionists wish to apply principles as were understood 1400 years back. And the liberal constructionist wishes to take the principle out and apply it to today's reality. That's the larger debate. And I think that debate needs to go on. So just saying living our lives in accordance with Islam, that's not the issue. What does Islam actually mean and how is it going to be implemented is the issue.
Babar, just the question that another young fellow raised. Is a lower court treatment...
I've already said that. I don't think the justice system treats minorities equally. I think there is clear discrimination in our attitudes, in the attitudes of the majority, socially, in the attitudes of our legal system. And our constitution isn't an equal document, not for minorities, not for FATA, and not for many other vulnerable segments of the society.
Zain sir, would you like to comment on this constitutionalism and Professor Shtiaq raised? So any point about it?
Sir, what he has said is actually true. And what has happened and how the states have evolved and how the state and its relation with the people has evolved is quite true. And that's what we have written in our study also, as to how the relation between constitution and the social theory and the constitutionalism has evolved, and it should be evolving. It should not stop just there and then.
I take now two more points. My apology. Haris is there. If you could, Haris Khalik. No, yeah, your point.
So I just wanted to comment on something which Babar has already spoken about. But it's just that in a society like Pakistan, I tend to agree with the gentleman that 80% or 90% or whatever percentage of people. You know, demographically speaking, 96% perhaps want an Islamic, an abstract notion. They believe in an abstract notion of Islamic system, and they would never say no if you ask them whether they want to live in conjunction with the teachings of Quran or Sunnah. So you have already answered that, Babar. But I just want to, you know, further that by saying that the problem in Pakistan with extreme right, or problem elsewhere also, with extreme right or religious right, is that they want to create a society which never was. And that makes it really abstract. And the problem with the far left is that they want to create a society which never will be. So I think there has to be a kind of a struggle, which Batra Sahab has already identified, that this has to happen in tandem. I mean, because if the state discriminates against the weaker segments of its citizens, then you know you end up nowhere. So if the state starts legislating correctly, and of course the courts correspond by their judgments, but at the same time people like yourself, Irfan Saab and Shaqaib and Safiya and Zain and Babar, of course, I mean, there has to be an attitudinal change which has to you know, we have to struggle for in tandem with the changes in the legal system. Thank you.
Inko dijiye ji.
My question is that your explanation and interpretation of Islam, religion, is all right. But at the same time, we are a democratic society. To me, democracy means liberties and equalities. When we make one religion the religion of the state, then equality is shattered. There will be no equality. So my second point is that state cannot be, modern state cannot be partisan. So I...
Thank you very much. One last comment from it. Sorry. I gave you the opportunity, but probably you surrendered. So now I have to go to this. Yeah, give it to you.
Sir, my query is directed to Mr. Babar Yaz. Mr. Babar Yaz, sir, firstly...
Babar Sattar.
My apologies, sir. Sir, my English is light. I'll speak in Urdu. Firstly, you will translate my query to in English for the benefit. Sir, kya aisa nahi hai ki jin logon ko humne 14 August 47 se pehle Pakistani ya Musliman jana ya samjha, uske baad agar jo kuch bhi kiya gaya, jo maada wo sab ghair aini hai, agar aisa hai, to waam Pakistan is the moment coercive apparatus of states falls down upon from the usurper, usko zabardasti badal dein ya khayal se badal dein.
Thank you. Since we have to now wrap it up, Babar sir, just final concluding comments and then I'll wrap it up. Yes.
I'm sorry, sir, I didn't understand the question.
Anyway, sorry. Yeah. I don't know whether you'll be able to answer it, but probably he's referring to another character of Islam, I don't know.
Sir, I'm saying 14 August se pehle chale gaye Pakistan tod de agar ye gaya nahi
hai. Acha ji, thank you. I give you 1 minute to really just help us in terms of how best we can create a state which is more democratic and responsible to its states and not just an ideology. Because state, in any literal definition, has to be a protector and benefactor to its citizens and not just an ideological opponent. What do you think we should be doing in terms of our political struggle?
Sir, I think there is freedom of conscience is like a fundamental right. We talk about that. We talk about the right to dignity. I think it's the majority, it's us who have to change really and ask ourselves. There's John Rawls came up with a theory of justice, which was that it's a society where nobody knows what roles you're going to be assigned. You put together the rules of the game and then you assign roles later. And so when you're actually putting together those rules, nobody knows what position you're going to get. And so you try to be fair. Because we are a majority, we're not being fair. And I think it's for us to actually ask what would we feel like, what is the reason we created Pakistan or our forefathers created Pakistan, because we thought we were not being treated equally. And then you create a country from a minority, you become a majority and you do the exact same thing to the minorities in that country. So I think there is need for introspection. There is need to ask the difficult questions. There is need to point out our own hypocrisy and then begin the process of change.
Thank you very much. Yeah, friends, my apologies for those who wanted to raise questions or make comment. It's just because of the time constraint. I've been told that we have to wrap it up. Thank you very much. The purpose of the session was actually to look at this whole issue of equality and inequality, as my friend said, from the angle of constitution and constitutionalism. I think we have got some answers, not all. And this was not even possible to have a very comprehensive discussion in just a span of 1 hour. But I think that we have given you some key points which will add to the social discourse and discussion that should continue and that should not stop. Because what we see is the discussion is not only in the courts or in social forums, but it is also being done in the streets and in violent manner. So let's take our role to address all of it. In the concluding session, concluding line, I would just quote Thomas Jefferson, who was the creator of constitutionalism. He said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that those amongst these are life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness." I think these are the guiding principle that Thomas Jefferson provided us while we were the Constitution was written in US. So let's follow if we really think that the Constitution should guarantee these fundamental rights to its citizens. Thank you very much for your presence, and thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the panelists and audience for being with us this session. Our next session, Nayi Kahani, Nayi Log, will start at 12:15. Those of you who wish to stay on for this session, please remain seated. Those of you who wish to attend sessions elsewhere, please step outside. Thank you very much.